And the next speaker this morning is Krzysztof Krupinski from Wroclaw, and he will talk about amenable theory.
Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me, and also apologize for my strange voice. But I was coming back last weekend from a conference in Mexico, and unfortunately got a cold. So I hope I will not lose my voice completely during the talk. So this is a certain new notion introduced by myself, Hrushovski, and Anand, Pillay. And it's a part of a paper that we are preparing now. So I will, of course, define this notion. The general motivation for the research that we are doing is to find mutual interactions and translations between model theoretic properties and topological dynamical properties, to get information and to use techniques in both directions. In this particular research, we are trying to understand consequences of various notions of amenability in the context of model theory, for example, for definable groups, amenability for definable groups in first-order structures, as well as this new notion of amenable theories, and try to understand the consequence of having appropriate measures, because amenability will be about the existence of certain measures, consequences. And the main consequence, most of our main results in this paper are of the form that amenability in the appropriate category implies a version of G-compactness. I will define what G-compactness means for theories, but there are also counterparts of this notion for definable groups. And always we have this result that amenability in appropriate category implies G-compactness. And it uses various tools also related to approximate group theory, a certain version of stabilizer lemma proved by Massicott and Wagner and so on. But these are like ultimate results, but also the developments in between, what is going on with these measures are important. So, but during today's talk, I will not be talking about this context of definable groups. I will be talking about this other context of amenable theories, although I will recall what are definably amenable groups, because this notion is defined by analogy to define the amenable group. So let me first start from, not from the main topic, but from something already well known in model theory, quite well developed. So these are definable amenability. Definable amenability. So I'm starting first from the classical definition of a discrete amenable group, I'm just recalling well-known definition from group theory or topological dynamics. So a discrete group G is amenable if there is a G invariant finitely additive finitely additive probability measure on the Boolean algebra of all subsets of our group G, of our discrete group G. So this is the collection of all subsets. Probability means that the measure of the whole group is 1. Okay, so this is a classical definition, and now typically in model theory we are interested not in all subsets of our universe, but only in, we are interested in definable subsets. This is the difference between, one of the differences between the model theory and set theory. So we are only interested in those sets which are the first order definable using our language. So that's why the appropriate notion of amenability is defined like that. We look at this definition, but restricted only to definable sets. So a group G definable in a first order structure M. Definable means that this group as a set is a definable subset of M. So in other words, the set of realizations of some formula. And also the graph of group operation is also definable in appropriate product of M, Cartesian power. So this group is, is definably amenable. It's definably amenable if there is a G-invariant finitely additive probability measure on, instead of the algebra of all subsets, we just take the algebra def of G, which is just the algebra of all definable subsets of G. That's it. So these are definitions. We see that treating this G just as a discrete group, this definition is weaker. We require less. We require a measure on a smaller algebra, not on the algebra of all sets. And because of that, and this is very essential difference, so the obvious remark is that if G is definable in a structure M, then if G is amenable as a discrete group, then of course it is definably amenable. So this immediately gives us a lot of examples, like all solvable groups definable in any structures are definably amenable. But there are examples like that. The free group, let's say with two generators, is definably amenable in the language of pure groups, just the group operation, is definably amenable because it is stable, it has a stable theory, and this is a general fact that every group definable in a stable theory is definably amenable. I am not going to discuss why, but the generally for model theories, the general reason is that we have the theory of generic types, and when we have a generic type, we have also a connected component G0, and then on the quotient G divided by G0, we have the Haar measure. And using the invariance of the generic type under translations by G0, we can take like the pullback of this Haar measure to get the measure on the original group. So there is a general reason in stable theories for that. So it is definably amenable, but not amenable. And of course, in this example, we use I said, I think, okay. And this, of course, uses this deep result of Zivicella that free groups are stable. Yes. Okay, so this is the difference, and maybe one last fact about this. As I said, this notion of definable amenability plays a very important role in model theory. It was used, for example, to prove the so-called Pillay's conjecture on definably relating definably compact groups, definable in minimal structures, with real Lie groups. So this was used there, but there is also like a big theory of definably amenable groups with a very beautiful paper by Chernikov and Simon where they prove various interesting things. So, but let me state one more fact that if G is definable in M, then we can express definable amenability in different terms, in terms of flows and existence of measures on flows, but what kind of flow is interesting for us, relevant for us. So we have the following equivalence. The group G is definably amenable if and only if there is a G invariant Borel probability measure on the space of types SG of M. So what is this SG of M? So normally S of M denotes all complete types over M. complete types means that for every formula over M, either this formula or its negation belongs to our type. This G means that our types are concentrated on G, which means they contain the formula defining G. So they are like, okay, on G. And this is a space of types. In other words, it is the space of all ultra filters of M definable subsets of G. And the group G acts naturally on the left, on this space, let's say moving every set from the ultra filter by G. So we have the natural action, and the action of the group G on this, this is a compact Hausdorff space, this action is by homeomorphisms. So the pair G acting on this space is a flow, is a G flow. And our equivalent formulation of amenability just says that on this flow we have here a Borel probability measure on this space, which means on the algebra of Borel sets. And this is a standard extension measure procedure, because normally when you have this measure on definable sets, then definable sets corresponds here to Clopen subsets. So it's like you have a measure on Clopen subsets, and then by standard extension procedures you can get a measure, a Borel measure on this space. But anyway, we have this expression in terms of more dynamical terms. And now let me go to the main topic of today, namely amenable theories. Amenable theories. So our context is the following. T is a first order theory in any language, complete. For me, the theories are always complete when we are doing definable theory.
For probability measure, you really mean sigma additive, not just additive.
Yes, sigma additive, yes. But this one is, of course, finitely additive here, because it does not make sense to the union of countable family of definable sets, it's not countable. But here you get, from this measure, you get finitely additive measure on the Boolean algebra of Clopen subsets, and this extends to the sigma additive. Yes, so when I'm saying measure, I mean sigma additive. Otherwise, I'm saying finitely additive, like here. Yeah. So first order complete theory. And let's see, a monster model of our theory. What does it mean? So it means that it is kappa saturated. I will say what it means. Kappa saturated, that's something that in model theory we call strongly kappa homogeneous, but maybe for people in set theory it would be like just kappa homogeneous, strongly kappa homogeneous. So what it means? For a big kappa. So usually we assume that it's a strong unit cardinal greater than the cardinality of T, but for most of my discussion, for the definitions and so on, it's enough to take kappa equal to Aleph 0. So for example, for the definition and equivalent formulations of amenability, it will be enough to have kappa equal to Aleph 0. And what is kappa saturated? It just means that when this model is kappa saturated, it means that if you take any set of parameters of cardinality less than kappa, then any complete type over this set of parameters has a realization inside this model. So this model is rich enough. And strong kappa homogeneity means that if you have any two subsets of our model of cardinality smaller than kappa, and you have an elementary map between these two subsets, then it extends to an automorphism of our model. And as I said, for the purpose of the definitions of amenability, it's enough to take kappa equal to Aleph 0. And the definition of amenability will not depend on the choice of this monster model as long as it is Aleph 0 saturated and strongly Aleph 0 homogeneous. So it's a really property of the theory, not of a particular model of the theory. So what is going to be the definition? So we will introduce this definition by analogy with this fact. But then I will state a remark or a proposition which tells us that it can be also stated by analogy with this definition here. So first let me say, what does it mean that a partial type is, let's say, P of X over the empty set, which means the formulas in this type does not use any parameters. So such a type is amenable. So this is the notion that we define. If there is an odd C invariant, odd C is the group of all automorphisms of this model, it's a first order structure. If there is an odd C invariant, Borel probability measure, so once again sigma additive, on the following space of types. So this notation here means that these are all types, complete types over C, which extend this partial type P, which is over the empty set. So this means that this collection of formulas P of X is a collection of formulas, it's a type, yes, is contained in Q of X. So this is a closed subset of the space of all complete types. So it's a compact Hausdorff space. And this group, odd C, acts on this space in the obvious way. It just moves every. If you have a type, it consists of formulas over C. So you just apply the automorphism to the parameters, and each formula in your type is moved appropriately, and the whole type is in this way moved. So we have this natural action, and moreover, if you treat this as a topological group with pointwise convergence topology, meaning that every automorphism is a function from C to C, from the monster model to the monster model, you put the discrete topology on C and you just take the product topology. So if you take this topology on this group, which makes it a topological group, then the action of this group on this space is continuous. So it is a flow in the sense of topological dynamics. So we claim the existence of a measure on this flow. I will come back to this in a moment, but now let me state a proposition definition of amenable theories. So T is amenable if the following equivalent conditions hold. So proposition tells us that these conditions are equivalent, and the definition that this means that the theory is amenable. So let me write a few of them. So all partial types over the empty set are amenable according to the above definition. Partial types in any number of variables, possibly infinite number of variables. Second, all complete types also in arbitrary number of variables are amenable. Three, all finitary complete types, are amenable. Finitary means with only finite variables. Four, all consistent formulas over empty set are amenable. So a consistent formula is an example of a partial type, but very special type, just given by one formula. So it's enough to have this existence of measures only for formulas. These are the basic things that I say. And one more. If we take the type of M bar over the empty set, then it is amenable. Where, or for some, equivalently for every, for some model, for some M bar enumerating some model, elementary substructure of C. So this is a complete type over the empty set, but of enumeration of a model. So these are all equivalent conditions, and basically the proofs of the equivalences are applications of compactness, sometimes ultra-product constructions, and so on. Some of the equivalences are completely trivial. For example, if all partial types are amenable, then in particular all complete types are amenable, because complete types are also partial types. But on the other hand, from 2 to 1 is also very easy. If you take any partial type, you can extend it to a complete type. Then, working with this complete type, you have a measure. You have a measure on this space, but then your measure is a Borel probability measure concentrated on this complete type. So, in particular, it is concentrated on your original partial type, which was the subtype of this complete type. And the most maybe involving is this step that it's enough to have it for formulas, to have it for all the types. And this is by some ultra product construction. It's not very difficult. So, okay, we have this. But all these definitions are terms of flows, yes, because they say that some types or formulas are amenable. Oh, there's lots of water here. Okay, so let me. So this is it. And now, remark. So let me emphasize here that it's enough to have that Aleph 0, it's enough to have Aleph 0 saturation and strong Aleph 0 homogeneity. So suppose we have such a model, then this is a very important, very easy but important remark, which gives us shows that we are talking about a large class of theories. Because then if ot M is amenable, as a topological group, once again with pointwise convergence topology, I could write here C, my monster model, but usually somehow in model theory, the monster model means that this kappa is much, much bigger than Aleph 0. So that's why when I'm writing explicitly Aleph 0, I prefer to write just M, not C. So it's amenable as a topological group with the pointwise convergence topology here, then the theory of this model, so this is the collection of all sentences true in this model, it's a complete theory, is amenable. Very easy remark, let me, so I can prove it, because it's very easy. So, okay, I will maybe not write this G. Okay, so we have this assumption that our group of automorphisms is amenable. And I recall what it means. I didn't say yet today what it means that a topological group is amenable. I only said what it means that a discrete group is amenable. It is on the top of this blackboard. But now this is a topological group, so it is amenable. By definition, it means that for every... maybe it will be convenient to denote this group here, locally in this group by G. So for every G flow, Gx, so G flow means that this is a compact Hausdorff space, and the action of G on X is continuous, jointly continuous, it's a two variable function. So for every G flow, this is compact Hausdorff, there exists a G invariant Borel probability measure on X. This is definition. This definition of an amenable group. For every flow, we have this action, but we have this measure. But in the definition on this blackboard, in the definition of amenability of the type, we see that uh, that we are considering the following flows, only the following flows, the space of complete types concentrated on any partial type over the empty set, and the action of G on this, which I said is always continuous. So it's an example of a flow. And we are saying, so let me say, but this is a G flow. This is a G flow for any partial type P of X over the empty set. And that's it. This is the proof. Here we have the existence of a measure for every flow, and our definition of amenability of the theory tells us that there is a measure on every flow of this form. So it's, we see that it's weaker. And this is once again the same kind of differences as was discussed between amenability of the discrete group and definable amenability of a definable group, where we were talking about measures only on definable sets, and here similarly. Classical amenability is a measure for all flows, our amenability only on flows of types, which makes this class, once again, larger than amenable, than classical amenable topological groups. And now let me discuss some examples. So let's say corollary of this remark. So this Kehry's, famous Kehry's Pestov Todorcevich. Todorcevich in theory yields many examples of omega categorical. Omega categorical means the theory such that it has only one model up to only one countable model up to isomorphism. Omega categorical Fresset limits M with odd M, even extremely amenable. Even extremely amenable, then in each such situation, by this remark, the theory of our model is amenable in our sense. Even extremely. I didn't define it, but extremely amenable. Maybe I should say that. So, extreme amenability in topological dynamics means that for every, like here we have this definition. So extreme amenability means that for every G flow, that there is a fixed point. Here we are talking about invariant measure, but extreme amenability means point, which is a particular case of a measure, like concentrated in one point. And following this, we can of course define in our context extremely amenable theories by changing the definition to say that always in this tight space SP of C, there is a type which is invariant under the action of the automorphism group. And in fact, this Kehry's Pestov-Todorcevich theory gives us examples. I think I'm afraid I don't have time to discuss this Fresset limits, but this is basically when we have a collection of functions, structures, finite structures or finitely generated structures in some language, which has some nice property called hereditarity, that every substructure of a structure in our family is still in our family. Amalgamation property, that when we have this amalgam, we can amalgamate it to one structure. And joint embedding property, then there is a unique object called the Fresset limit, such that, which is very, very homogeneous, we say ultra homogeneous, and also the collection of finite substructures of this structure is exactly up to isomorphism, our original family. Then Kehry's Pestov-Todorcevich give Ramsey theoretic characterization of when the automorphism group of such a limit is amenable. And this Ramsey theoretic property concerns the Fresset system that we start from. And basically this Ramsey property is, appropriate Ramsey property is equivalent to amenability. So, for example, the the theory of dense linear orders, so the theory of the rationals with inequality, is extremely amenable, is an extremely amenable theory by this approach. But in fact, I would like to emphasize here that our situation is much more general than this, and more generally, okay, maybe I should say, e.g., the theory of random graph, this is random graph, the theory of Hume, they are, so this is just, this theory is just denoted by dense linear orders without endpoints. So these are amenable theories, and more generally, any omega categorical Fresse limit of a Fresse system of a Fresse class, maybe I don't know. Okay. Class with something that one could call a canonical amalgamation is extremely amenable. So it's like a much more general situation than just this in Kekris-Pestov-Todorcevich, because we have to once again remember that his notion, this notion of amenability here means that the group of automorphism of the Fresse limit as a topological group is amenable or extremely amenable. In our case, now our notion is much weaker. We say only that there are measures on directions of type spaces. So we only care about first order logic here. And this canonical amalgamation means basically that there is a certain functor. And okay, I prepared a little explanation of this, but I'm not sure if maybe I will skip it. If there is time, then maybe at the end I will discuss what I mean by this and why we get such situation. But anyway, using this, we can very easily recover this without talking about Ramsey property and also some other things, like, for example, groups of automorphisms of infinite linear space over finite fields is also amenable. Is also amenable theory, for example, by this. So canonical amalgamation. Okay, now another example are various pseudo-finite structures or theories of pseudo-finite structures. So for example, if M is a pseudo-finite field, then the theory of M is amenable. So pseudo-finite means that it is just, one can think for simplicity, an ultra-product of a family of finite fields, or any field whose theory is exactly the theory of such an ultra-product. And basically, I'm not sure, when I was preparing this talk, I'm not sure, maybe any pseudo-finite structure has amenable theory, but there are some. Because you can always take the ultra-product of counting measures, but the problem is that it's not so clear if this ultra-product of counting measures is an invariant measure. This invariance is a problem. But for finite fields it works, as well as for measurable structures in the sense of MacPherson, but maybe this is something to be checked if it is always the case. So this is another class of amenable theories. Basically, the measure that we get is just the ultra-product of counting measures on our finite fields. Yes, okay, and now there will be a very big class of examples that I will discuss at the end also. For example, all stable theories are amenable and much more, but this will be later. Now I would like to give one more equivalent definition of amenability, which is in terms of the, which is analogical to the first definition there of definable amenability for definable groups. So let me. So M is a model, then OTM can be identified with the following. We take M bar, let it be an enumeration of the model M, and then we take just all the images of this tuple M bar by elements of our automorphism group. So of course every element, every automorphism is uniquely determined by saying what is sigma of M bar. Yes? So we can, so in this way we can think that OTM is embedded in our model, namely as a collection of tuples, various enumerations of our model. And then I want to say that I would like to express my amenability as an existence of a measure on some subsets of this group. But this will be not all subsets. This will be certain subsets which I call relatively definably amenable. So now I'm going to define this. So a relatively definable subset of the group of automorphisms of a given model is a set of of the form the collection of all automorphisms. As I said, every automorphism can be identified with this tuple. So this will be the collection of all automorphisms such that all automorphisms which are given by some formula. So this is like relatively definable by this formula, but relatively because it's not the set of all realizations of this formula, but only realizations of the formula which are of the form sigma of m bar. So it's a restriction to this collection of tuples sigma of m bar. So for some where p of x y is a formula. Usually, when we talk about formulas, we use finitely many variables, but we can always extend artificially the tuple so that it coincides with the enumeration of M bar. It's not a problem. So these are relatively definable subsets, those subsets that are given by formulas. And second point, we say that OT M is relatively definably amenable if there is an OTM invariant finitely additive probability measure. So now on the finitely additive on the Boolean algebra. The Boolean algebra of relatively definable subsets of OT M. Okay, so in OT M you have a certain Boolean algebra of sets of this form, and we say that there is a measure, finitely additive measure, only on those subsets. So it exactly corresponds to the definition of definably amenable group. But the only point is that we have to express, there we had for free the notion of a definable subset. But here we have to replace it by this relatively definable subsets. And notation is, when I have a formula and tuples AB, then in this way I denote the collection of all automorphisms of M, such that which are defined by the formula phi. So here I can think that these are finite tuples, for example, and I'm just taking all the sigmas that are given by this formula. So this is an example of, this is a relatively definable subset of my group. And now remark saying that what I define here is equivalent to to the notion of amenability of the theory. And actually, this was first the original definition that we had, and then we came up with this, so it became equivalent. But in practice, to prove our main result that I will formulate soon, then we use this approach via these relatively definable subsets and measures living on the group, not on the type space. So, remark, M is a, suppose that we take M Alex 0 saturated and strongly Alex 0 homogeneous, then odd M is relatively definably amenable in the sense of this definition that there is the measure on the Boolean algebra of relatively definable subsets if and only if T is amenable. So this is one more to this list of five conditions. We have the sixth one, which is sort of different than the others. And let me write a very short sketch of the proof. So it's also easy, it's nothing deep here. So when we have a measure, let's say, measure on relatively definable subsets of odd M, and we want to produce in two ways, in two directions, a measure mu, measure on Sm bar of M. So Sm bar of M, I didn't introduce this notation, but maybe I can introduce it now. So this is just this space, where here I take the type of M bar over M set, that's all complete types over M. So these are just all complete types over M, extending the type of M bar over the empty set. Okay? So, and by point number five here, we see that having a measure on Borel invariant probability measure on this space is enough, it's equivalent to amenability of the theory. So I need only, having a measure on this relatively definable subsets, I need to produce a measure on this, and vice versa, from this I need to produce this. And so now, this is completely clear, the first thing, what to do. The first thing is, okay, I take a measure, I define the measure. What is this? This is typical model theoretic notation. I have a formula, and with this bracket, I denote this the collection of all complete types containing this formula. So, but in this case, I restrict only to types extending the type of M over the empty set. So this is a basic Clopen set of my space, and I define this measure just by putting that this is a measure of A, phi, M. M. So this is the measure, the definition of this A is given here. So this is basically it, and then having this measure on Clopen subsets by standard extension construction of measures, I can extend it to a Borel probability measure, and vice versa is exactly the same definition, but now this measure is given, so I define this measure by this formula. And strong Aleph 0 homogeneity and Aleph 0 saturation is needed to show that if I define this as this, that it is well defined, and so on. So, okay, so we see we have this, and now let me go to the last part of my talk. Last part of my talk, which is about this G compactness. This will be something maybe more trivial. I didn't use water. It's not that wet. I think I can skip. Strong types in model theory. So we have types play fundamental role in model theory, but also strong types, the so-called shellac strong types, in stable theories, Kim-Pillay types in simple theories, and in general, Laskar-Strong types. These are very important notions. And what is Shellac-Strong type? This is the intersection of all definable finite equivalence relations on the monster model or on any product of sorts in this monster model, depending on what we want to study. And by finite, I mean with finitely many classes. And then there is a notion of AKP. This is the relation of having the same Kim-Pillay strong type. So this is the finest bounded, which means by definition with less than kappa classes, equivalence classes, where kappa is the degree of saturation of our monster model. But in fact, it will be equivalent that this number of classes is at most 2 to the cardinality of the theory. So both things are equivalent. 0 type definable, it means without parameters, 0 type definable equivalence relation. And here also 0 definable, if I'm talking about types over the empty set. And then EL. This was the finest bounded zero-type definable equivalence relation. EL will be the finest bounded invariant equivalence relation. So the finest bounded invariant, I would say zero, okay, odd C invariant, let me write it, with respect to the group of all automorphisms of the monster model. So of course, zero type definable equivalence relations are invariant because they are given. Type 0 type definable means that it's a set of realization of a type over the empty set. So 0 type definable set is always invariant under the group of automorphisms. So that's why it is possible that this relation is finer than this one, because we have more invariant sets than 0 type definable sets. And this is called Shellac-Strong type, this is Kim-Pillay strong type, and this is Laskar-Strong type relation, or classes of these relations are called these types. And with this we have associated certain subgroups of the group of all automorphisms of the monster model. So these are just groups fixing set-wise each class of our, I don't know, of our relation in question. So these are all automorphisms fixing the class of every element, and this is easy to see that it's always a normal subgroup of odd C, and we have analogous definition putting L everywhere for Laskar, and this leads to the associate notions of Galois groups of our theory. So the Kim-Pillay Galois group, it is odd C divided by this group odd FKP of C, and similarly the Laskar Galois group, which is often, this is called just the Galois group of the theory, is just odd C divided by the group of the so-called Laskar-Strong automorphism, which is defined here. And by the way, this relation EKP will be just the orbit equivalence relation of this group, and similarly for the Laskar group. And this group has a certain natural topology, which makes it a compact topological group, which is Hausdorff. And this is also a compact topological group, but not necessarily Hausdorff, which is a kind of big problem, how to treat this as a mathematical object, because this topology is not so useful. And similarly for the quotients by these relations. And now the theory is definition. The theory is said to be G-compact. If on any possible product of sorts, or on any tuples, in other words, even of infinite length, these two relations agree. And this is equivalent to saying that this group out, sorry, this should be F here, we write F. This group odd FKP coincides with odd FL. Another characterization is that this group is compact Hausdorff, is Hausdorff. So this means that, yeah, that the theory is G-compact. And in this G-compact theory is this problem that, for example, the quotient space C divided by L is not necessarily Hausdorff disappears, because this is just C by EKP, which is a very nice compact Hausdorff space, and similarly for the Galois groups. And our main theorem concerning amenable theories is the following. So, without any assumptions, no any stability theoretic assumptions, just T, any theory which is amenable, this implies that T is G-compact. And this proof is quite involved. As I said, it uses some ideas from approximate group theory, some topological considerations concerning these Galois groups, and some other measure theoretic notions, and using this equivalent definition of amenability by saying that odd M, the group of automorphisms of the monster model, is relatively definably amenable. And let me finish. Unfortunately, I don't have time to say anything about the idea of this proof, but let me only say that for extreme amenability, this is almost trivial. It's like a four-line proof, but in general, for amenability, it's much more complicated. So, let me state one more proposition. Then, the following conditions are equivalent. So, T is amenable. Aha, but here I assume NIP. This is an important class of theories in model theory containing stable theories, but containing such fundamental examples as algebraically closed fields with valuation. It is very intensively studied in recent years. I will not go into the details of the definition, but believe that, it's one of the most important classes of theories. So in this case, we have a very good characterization of amenability. So the theory is amenable if and only if the empty set is an extension base for torquing, which for model theorists means that every type over the empty set does not fork over the empty set. For example, all O-minimal structures are like that, or C-minimal structures, or P-minimal, whatever. I don't remember the definitions of P-minimal. Okay, so but not all theories with NIP have this property. For example, the circle with circular order does not have this property. So there is P. So let C be a monster model and C bar enumeration of this monster model. So these are all types, complete types over C, extending the type of C bar over the empty set. So there is such a type with bounded orbit. Bounded means of cardinality smaller than kappa, where kappa is the degree of saturation of our monster model. And finally, there is P in SC of C, which is odd F KP of C invariant. So we have characterizations in various terms, and let me only say, because this is a very important idea in general in model theory, how we produce measures in various definable environments. So how to get a measure knowing that we have such a type with bounded orbit, which is equivalent that this type is odd FKP of C invariant. How to get from such a type a measure? So this is standard construction. So idea of the proof of 4 implies 1. How to get a measure from one type with small orbit. So take P of X B, and let's say this tuple corresponds, it's an infinite tuple, very long, corresponds to the enumeration of C, and put S phi bar as the collection of all elements of this King Pillay Galois group. So it means these are cosets modulo tell p of c, such that the formula phi of x b bar belongs to sigma of p. So we just look at all these automorphisms for which phi belongs to sigma of p. And now put, we define already our measure, put mu on the relatively definable subset of the group of automorphisms given by this formula. So I denote this subset by phi c bar. This notation is still somewhere, I think. Oh yeah, it's here. So this is a relatively definable subset of my group of automorphisms of the monster model given by this formula and this set of parameters. So I define this as H of S phi bar, where, remember that these elements here, they belong to Gal KP of T, but this is a compact Hausdorff group, so it has a unique invariant Haar measure. So H, the Haar measure, on this compact Hausdorff group. And I'm using this Haar measure, and I'm saying that my relatively definable subset is just the Haar measure of this. But why do I need this NIP? So the NIP, and the fact that this type is invariant under odd FKP, is needed to show that this set is Borel measurable. Otherwise, this H of the set would not make sense. So by NIP, I'm not telling how to do it, but I'm saying only where it is used. So by NIP and odd FKP of C invariance of P, this set SP bar is Borel measurable, is Borel. So the definition makes sense, and this is how we get from small. Okay, so this is like this is in this paper concerning amenable theories, this is the main result. In another paper with Simon and Neversky, it was yet before we introduced the notion of amenable theory, but we used this condition here, which is, as we see, equivalent to amenability. We proved another non-trivial result relating topological dynamics to Galois groups. Yeah, and we proved basically that the Ellis group in a certain situation is isomorphic to this King Pillay Galois group. Sorry, thank you very much. I'm sorry.
Questions. Yeah. I don't know if we have time, but I'll try shortly. I'm kind of curious. You said that free groups are amenable in this sense. So, like, there are two reasons to be amenable. One is like if it's really amenable, and one if there are very few definable subsets, right? I guess
yes.
This is the case of the free group.
Yes.
So, like, hyperbolic groups are also amenable in this sense. What?
Do they have stable theory?
Yeah.
Okay, so they are.
So, but it's automatically a coil of stable?
Yes, it's automatic, and the reason is very similar to this idea that I presented here.
Uh-huh.
Namely, the point is that we have something called a generic type, which is invariant under certain connected component. And you can pull back once again the measure from the Haar measure on a certain quotient.
And a subgroup, and our subgroup of, I mean, I'm sure that a definable subgroup of amenable is amenable.
But
arbitrary subgroup of amenable is amenable in your sense, because that's a classical. And another question compared to the classical.
But what you said is true, but in classical sense, but only for discrete group. For topological groups, it's not true that
it's
every
closed.
Subgroup is.
Well, it's closed. Yeah. But it's not true for discrete groups. In your sense, that the subgroup of definable.
No, in my sense, okay. If I have a definable group, then I think it follows from my definition.
No,
yes.
A definable subgroup will be a definable amenable, but
yes.
An arbitrary subgroup of.
Okay, but then when you are talking about arbitrary subgroup, then if it's not definable, then you are changing the whole structure.
I understand, but do you have an example that indeed it's not true? I mean, that's the question.
I believe that it's not true, but I would have to think about it. Yeah.
Uh-huh. And a last question, you know, in the classical, you have this connection with non-amenability and a Banach paradox, you know, the fact that you can do. Do you have here that a group will be definable, amenable, if and only if there is no decomposition, a paradoxical, uh-huh. in a definable sense?
I think that, okay, in the first paper of Pillay, Hrushovski and Peterzin, where they used, there was, I think there is this kind of correspondence, but it's been a while since I saw it last time, so I don't want to say something false, but they were considering some kind of decompositions in this, so I believe that there should be this kind of characterization.
Thank you.
Other questions? No? Then thank you again.
Thank you.